On this episode of The Authors Exchange, we sit down with Carole Mondragon, author of The Key to Clonacool.
And I have to say about the cover, I was expecting, that's where I expected the romance thing to come in there. It looks like something like one of those questionable novels I wasn't allowed to look at as a child. Is that her on the cover?
That's her grown up.
Okay.
The Authors Exchange. Your host, Captain Christopher Germ. Brought to you by The Charted Life. And sponsored by Whither We Tend, a novel by Captain Christopher German. Welcome to The Authors Exchange.
Ladies and gentlemen, you have just joined us for the next episode of The Authors Exchange. I'm Captain Christopher German, your host. This is a half-hour program we air once a week. It goes out on YouTube and everywhere you find good podcasts. We just started our own website, theauthorsexchange.com. If you would like to get on that page, we would love for you to check it out. Tell us what you think. Tell us what you want on that website. But we think we've covered everything that you need to know about the podcast on that website, and that is at theauthorsexchange.com. It is live as of today. We just put our new episodes up, and it is good to go. So make sure you check that out. I have a really cool friend of mine that I've met through the Authors Exchange with me here today. She is a Irish-Canadian woman, and she has created this fabulous Irish tale that you need to take a look at, because it is a fun little read. And if you're at all a little Irish on St. Patrick's Day, we're all a little Irish, but in the middle of summer where it's coming out right now, we're just remembering what it was like to be on St. Patrick's Day. And so I'm trying to resurrect your Irishness today. And we're going to go all the way to Ireland, and we're going to meet Carole Mondragon. And let me tell you a little bit about her. About Carole Mondragon. She is a Canadian-Irish author living in a 200-year-old cottage in the west of Ireland. Last Christmas, she went to Ireland for 3 months, but then COVID-19 happened, and she decided to cocoon there for a while. Storytelling is an oral tradition in her family, passed down from mother to daughter through the generations. As a child on her mother's knee on long winter nights before a crackling fire, she listened enthralled to tales of Irish ancestors in the beloved country they left behind. She's nurtured this in her grandchildren, passing on those same stories, which she hopes they will pass on to their grandchildren, and so on and so on. Graduate studies in Irish history, folklore, and mythology led to a passion for writing and a membership in the Irish Writers Union. She and her Anglo-Irish husband, Peter, have embraced the wonderful world of Western Ireland, where folklore and magic are taken for granted, and the building of a county road will go around a hawthorn tree rather than disturb it. For as everyone knows, the hawthorn is sacred to the fairy folk, or as they say in Ireland, and tell me if I'm getting this right, Aelshi. Did I say it right?
Yeah.
I did say it right. Yes. Okay. I had to listen to Google that 20 times, pronounce that. Well, I've already introduced you enough. So tell us about your book, ma'am.
Okay. The Key to Clonacool. And here it is. The Key to Clonacool. It is a story that I wasn't expecting to write, because when I sat down to write, I was, of course, in Ireland, and I was hoping to write like Maeve Binchy. I don't know if you've heard of Maeve Binchy. She was an Irish author who lived in Dublin, and she wrote about ordinary, everyday Irish people going about their lives, and was a huge success. Her books were a huge success, and I have every one of them. But on this 200-year-old property, in this the back of this cottage, there is a hawthorn grove, and within that hawthorn grove, there is what the locals tell me is a fairy forth. And it's even on ordnance maps as a fairy forth. It is reputed to be a portal to the Tuatha De Dananann, the fair folk, the fairy folk, the good folk. And as I was trying to, I began the story with Kay, a young American woman arriving in Ireland. And after about a chapter, the characters suddenly decided that they wanted to go out the back door, across the meadow and into the fairy forth and take on a life of their own. And I fought them for almost a week trying to keep them back in reality. I didn't want magic in my stories. I hadn't even considered it. But they won out. And in the end, one day I thought, you know what, I'm just going to follow them for a day and see what happens. And I did. And this whole world that was obviously in my head and very much influenced by my living here just came out of nowhere, and the characters took off with it. And this whole trilogy that is now developing into more of a series came out. And all about the Tuatha De Nann and the Fomori, who were their arch enemies, nasty people, and how just the beauty of Irish mythology. And I think the most wonderful thing about living here in the west of Ireland is that mythology and folklore are still so very much alive that I mentioned a tree that's sitting in the middle of the meadow behind this cottage, and it's on the farmer's land. And I said to him, why is that still there? It looks like it's dead, and one of the branches is hanging right off of it. And he said, oh, well, I can't touch that now. It's a fairy tree, don't you know? And I said, well, what does that mean? Why can't you cut it down? Oh, sure, it would be bad luck to cut it down. And I thought, okay, that's fantastic. I love that. I love that mythology and folklore still exist here Ireland.
He didn't tell you the other part of why he won't cut that tree down is it's really hard work. And he doesn't want to do the hard work to cut the tree down.
Yes, yes, yes.
There's a practicality to all Irish lore I've found. And ultimately, there's a very pragmatic reason why things don't happen. But they put it into the fairyland and they give a reason for it there, don't they?
They are a very practical people, actually. Very down to earth and very practical. And yet there's this other side to things. You know, I heard somebody say when I was researching for the books, I came across this thing, and somebody was saying, do you believe in fairies? No, of course I don't believe in fairies, but they're just the same.
Well, and that's what's really cool about this book is you really... you really wrap it in some very thick Irish brogue that's going through the whole thing. And you really do, you know, immerse the reader in this Irish experience. You got a pub, you got ale all over the place. You got a bunch of drunks hanging out at the bar. They're talking to each other and getting into fights. You got hurling matches. You have all kinds of cool stuff. And then you wrap it all up with this nationwide fight to save the livestock of the country, and you wick it all into this world of fairydom and Aoshi. And you know, I was just fascinated actually by how your mind works and how you got all this stuff together to fit inside this book with inside the Irish traditions.
Mm-hmm. Well, it was very interesting because of course in Dublin they don't speak the way they do here. But here, people will say, ye have a fine day now, won't ye? And that kind of thing. And it's kind of an old fashioned way of speaking here. And I've just been drinking it all in. And I thought, well, why not? Why not just use what I'm hearing every day all around me and put it into the stories, you know? And so that was exactly what I was doing, just enjoying the fact that people were all around me using this language. And the one day, a couple of people came to visit, and my husband Peter said to him, is your wife still working? And he replied, sure she is. You can't beat a laying hen now, can you? But, oh, that's going right into the book.
Well, talk to me about... it says very prominently on your Amazon link for this book, and I just from the cover, which we could see, there's you expect a passionate tale of necking and fairydom and all kinds of good stuff like that. And in truth, when I got into this, the romance of this is, I think, largely a romance for the culture and not necessarily an interperson romance. Although there is some kind of romance between the fairy world and the human world, and they intersperse to each other, and there's a daughter of some kind of illicit relationship between that, and makes me blush just thinking about it.
That is true. And that is partly because Kay in book one, she has this relationship with a prince of the Tour de Dinan, who has been looking for his lost love for some centuries and believes that it is his care, or Kay, as she prefers, she thinks of herself. And then in book two, it is quite a hot romance. And Aoife is the product of that relationship. However, when I wrote book three, I confess that Aoife, you know, she was eight years old in book two, but in book three, she's an adult. But in my head, she was still Aoife at 8 years old. I couldn't bring myself to give her a hot romantic liaison. I just couldn't bring myself to do it. Even though the other two books are really, you know, they're quite intimate. I just couldn't do it.
Okay, so the first two books are, in fact, romance novels, and the second is the byproduct of romance novels.
yeah, that's true. And book three is also, because in book two, Kay sacrifices herself essentially and is taken off, goes off into Tirinanog, from which she can't come back easily, because 7 minutes there is 700 years in human time. So she actually is able to meet up at the end of book three with the person that she's actually in love with. So it's a lovely romance on several levels and for several people.
I think you definitely show your love of Ireland, and I think Ireland is showing its love for you. And we're going to talk about a little bit more about that when we come back from the break, because I want to hear how you got stuck in Ireland after the COVID-19 thing and how these books came to life and all that kinds of good stuff. But we have to take a little bit of a break. If you are on our Patreon page, you don't have to take a break. We'll come right back to you. But for the rest of you that are on YouTube and the podcast, you have to pay our bills by listening to these ads. So thank you for paying attention, and thank you for participating in the Authors Exchange. And today we have Carole Mondragon, author of The Key to Clonacool, and it is a true Irish romance tale with love for Ireland all over the place. So when we come back, we'll talk to her some more about her COVID-19 land, and we'll be right back after. Coming up on the Authors Exchange, we sit down with Christopher Barry D., author of Talking with Serial Killers. I think part of the reason I found such a troubling time with it is that I knew you were sitting there talking to the guy about it. I just can only imagine how uncomfortable that was. Was that tough for you?
No. It's a walk in. I'm ex-Royal Marine Commando Green Beret, and, you know, our servicemen, we done our bit, and then... I have got a Christian heart, and I do love the world, and I love the people in it. But when it comes down to dealing with these people, one has to have ice running through your veins. And the thing is, Michael was boasting about on camera and giggling about the strangulation, how many bruises around this girl's neck before she died. Yeah. And I just looked at him in the face and said, "Well, you're not exactly a Ted Bundy, are you?"
Available for our supporters now, ad-free on Patreon. And on July 2nd, 2021. Available on YouTube and wherever you can download your favorite podcasts free of charge.
And we're back. Thank you for watching the Authors Exchange. Today we're talking with Carole Mondragon, who's over in the west of Ireland, and she wrote the book, The Key to Clonacool. It is an Irish romance tale, and it is about the love of Ireland and the love of a man and a woman and a love of the fairy world and all of it wrapped together in a couple of novels. And it's just, it'll blow your hair back about how much fairyland stuff there is in this thing and why it's such a fun little tale. You can almost have yourself a bottle of Jameson's and just sit down there and eat some Irish soda bread for the afternoon and read the books. Have you done that yet?
Who, me? No, not okay, the good. Jameson's, but the soda bread for sure.
Have the best laugh. I love talking with you about that. Well, this is no laughing matter, unfortunately. Not to get too serious, but we have to, maybe we can laugh about it a little bit. Is COVID-19 was one of the makers of this book, was it not?
Yes, it was.
Talk to me about how that happened.
Well, I came over here at Christmas 2019, so a year and a half ago now, for Christmas, because we had bought this cottage 20 years ago, and my husband was coming over from Canada a month here and 2 months there every year. And finally, it was habitable enough that we could spend Christmas in it. And we came for a couple of months and then COVID began, and then it kind of gathered momentum and we realized that it was not going to be a good idea to go back. So we decided to quarantine here. And so because I was surrounded by all of this and magic really and beauty of this place and all the green and roses growing around the doorway in the middle of winter. And, you know, I just couldn't resist it. And I thought, you know, I've always wanted to write a book. I should sit down and I should try. And as I say, I started trying to write like Maeve Binchy, but this magical thing came out. And it went from there. You know, I never imagined that I would be here for all that time, or that I would, you know, produce three books, which when I had finished the third book, I got a lot of complaints from people all around the world saying, we don't want this series to end. It's not a trilogy, it's a series. We want this and that and the other to happen. So obviously I should go on, and it's no longer a trilogy, it's a series. So it will keep on going. It might morph a bit, but it will keep on going. Yeah.
Well, and I guess that means you're staying in Ireland for a bit longer, because you have to keep talking about the fairies to write this book, do you not?
I think so. I think so. In fact, I left quite a lot of my stuff there, obviously. And my kids and my grandkids have sort of taken it all apart, all our storage, and taken the bits that they want. And I was talking to my daughter this morning on Messenger and telling her to go ahead and take my books and distribute my stuff among the family, because it doesn't look like I'm going back there within the next few years, because, you know, things are not sorted out yet. And we have to just wait and see.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's funny. I have a interesting perch here, being the host of this program and talking to a bunch of authors and seeing the world as it is right now. And I am also one of those authors. I decided to quarantine in Utah. It wasn't exactly my preferred place to be, but it was where I had to go. And I quarantined out here in the middle of the desert, which is a very safe place to be from COVID-19, but it's not exactly a profitable place to be, which I imagine is the same kind of thing you ran in there. It's not like you're going to get a job as a brain surgeon on the western coast of Ireland, so you might as well write some books, correct?
I probably wasn't likely to get a job as brain surgeon anyway, so that was just fine. But because we're, you know, I'm on the edge of an Irish bog. We're in the middle of nowhere. They said you could only walk so many kilometers from your home, but I mean, I can walk for 2 hours here and not see anybody. So we would go shopping once a month, and we hardly even noticed that we were quarantined. It was just like that. We were so busy. Peter was busy building this place and making it more beautiful than it already was. I mean, I'm going to turn the thing around and,
go for
and
it.
Let you see. This is what he's
Oh,
produced.
Look at that fire.
You see that ceiling? Well, that was way lower than that. And, you know, he created all of this. And we just have a little bit of Shangri-La here that I absolutely love. I absolutely love it.
Well, perhaps you can help us understand your Shangri-La a little bit better by reading a little bit of your book. Would you do that for us? Show us the book, first of all, and then okay. Pick what you want to read.
Here it is. The Key to Clonacool. The cover was made by my granddaughter, Soraya Thompson-Wood.
I have to say about the cover, I was expecting it. That's where I expected the romance thing to come in there. It looks like something like one of those questionable novels I wasn't allowed to look at as a child. But in truth, she was 8 years old in your mind, so she couldn't do anything bad.
That's
Is
right.
that her on the cover?
Exactly. That's her grown up.
Ah, okay.
Yeah. Okay, it's just a couple of pages, okay? It's only three pages. It's not
Yeah, that's fine.
It's actually the prologue. The Fomori female crouched within a clump of alder trees. Cows in the adjoining meadow watched over the fence, their natural curiosity roused. Slinging a heavy pack from her thin shoulders, she extracted mold cuttings and grafted them carefully into the bark of each tree as high as she could reach. Her task accomplished, She rose and turned to view the field. Deep-set eyes looked out from beneath heavy brows as she carefully scanned for human intruders. Her pale face was in stark contrast to the black hair that was styled into a cap, close and short. Thin red lips curved into a wicked smile, completing the caricature of a distinctly sinister appearance. The malevolence of her expression was echoed within her soul. The Fomori had long been the enemy of the Tuatha De Dananann, or as they were generally known, the fair folk, fairy, fae, or even just the folk. Indeed, the Fomori were enemies of the Irish people themselves, for this mischief had also affected them throughout the centuries. Mouth twisting in sardonic satisfaction, the Fomori knew that through this act there would be chaos across the island of Ireland. The fair folk, she spat to one side in disgust at this name for them. The fair folk, she well knew, would strive as they usually did to protect the Irish people. Yet if her plan was successful and she saw no reason why it would not be so, the devastation would be more than even they could overcome. Satisfied that she had not been observed, she hefted her pack into a more comfortable position and returned to the road the way she had come. As she carefully closed the wide metal gate behind her, a flock of sheep trotted across the field. They reached the trees easily, whereas the cows were impeded for the moment by the pulsing of the white electrified tape that separated them from the sheep. Leaving their mothers behind, the lambs cavorted about, chasing each other on lightly bounding hoofs. Reaching the alders, they proceeded to chew on the delicious bark that hid the poisonous mold. It was of no matter that they ate from the base of the trees, for the higher seedings were untouched. In spring, such trees pollinated easily, saplings spreading across untended fields like weeds. Every form of farm animal in all of Ireland would be affected. Millions of animals would be lost. If the plan was successful, the blight would spread far beyond the island of Ireland. With a smirk of satisfaction, Ethnu of the Fomori, daughter to Balor of the Evil Eye, turned toward a circle of stones where a portal to the underworld opened to embrace her.
Well, there you go. There you go. That's pretty much the gist of what the characters of this book are going to be fighting against, but it is so great to hear it in the voice of the author. I think I'm enjoying hearing her. You should read the rest of the book one of these days to us and all. And did you do an audiobook with this?
Not yet, but I will be.
You gotta, because I think to get somebody with a good Irish accent to read this, that'd be a lot of fun.
Yes, I think so.
Okay. We're going to take a quick little break right now, and when we come back, we're going to talk to her a little bit about her publishing experience and how she got this trilogy. It's an independently published trilogy, and as you know, we love the independent authors here in the Authors Exchange. It's all about indie authors and indie bookstores and the independent book publishing industry, and that's what we're trying to do with this podcast, is create a whole new world, which she has done with this book, The Key to Clonacool. It's an entire world of fairies and Irish folk coming together to do amazing things and save the world from the evil Balor. But we got to take a break right now. So thanks for watching, and we'll be right back after these messages.
Do you remember what life was like before COVID-19? This is what book clubs used to look like. But because of COVID-19, maybe we all feel a bit more like this now. Thanks to Zoom, we can do all kinds of good stuff right now. We can have video conferencing, and we can go all over the world just because of internet. I'm looking for book clubs, whether you meet in person or virtually, to join me for the Authors Exchange podcast, where we talk to authors. I'll bring the authors, and I'll host the Zoom calls. All you have to do is read the books and ask good questions. It should be a lot of fun. If you want your book club to be part of the Authors Exchange Season 2, go to my website, theauthorsexchange.com, and send me your info and tell me you want your book club to be on Season 2. Thanks for watching. Have you heard about Whither We Tend? Whither We Tend is a novel for Americans about Americans. It takes recent political events and fictionalizes them and imagines what the world will look like in a couple of years and how things could turn out. It is my hope that they don't turn out this way. And that's why I wrote the book. And that's why I'm hoping you will read the book. because I don't want these events to take place in our country. And this book is my aim at trying to do that. I know not everybody likes to read, so I made it an audiobook. And with the code that you get in this video, you can download the Whither We Tend for absolutely free and listen to it, all 7 hours of it, and enjoy it, I hope. I'm told it's pretty good. I've gotten lots of 5-star reviews, and I'm hoping you'll give it a 5-star review as well. Take a look at Whither We Tend, a novel about Americans for Americans.
Welcome back. Thank you for watching. This is the Authors Exchange. If you've checked out our website, theauthorsexchange.com, you can see all the authors that have joined us this season, 18 of them. And we were on like episode, I forget which number we are on right now, but we have managed to get a tremendous amount of authors out here. And today we're in Ireland and we're speaking with the lovely, the amazing Carole Mondragon, and her book, The Key to Clonacool, is what we're talking about right now. And she is nestled away in the west of Ireland right now, very safe from COVID-19, but she managed to do something amazing. She tapped into the independent book publishing world, and she did it from her tiny little farmhouse on the shores of the western edge of Ireland. And ma'am, would you please regale us with those tales of how you got into the independent book publishing industry from your place out there?
Well, it's an interesting thing because writing the book is one thing. Marketing it is a whole other story. It is a journey of itself on its own. And when I began self-publishing, I published the books and then I went on to write the next one. And I did a couple of adverts on Facebook, which didn't produce much in the way of sales. And then I realized, I had to look more into it. And so I consulted a lot of people, talked to other authors, gleaned as much as I can, and began to post on other groups' pages. Now, I didn't post my, of course, it was all trial and error. But in the end, I realized it's not about posting adverts or talking about my books specifically on there. It's about creating my page or website, whichever you want to do, so that everything is there. And then going on to all of these different groups and making comments that will draw people to my website. So making interesting comments and putting interesting videos on there about Ireland and about the things that would attract them to my site, and just signing off as at Irish author Carole Mondragon. And if they click on there, it takes them to my website, and that's where they can see where they can purchase the book. And on my website, I have videos of myself reading excerpts from my book. And I have videos about the books that were made by my granddaughter, Soraya Thompson Wood. And she produced videos that are very enticing. They're like little movie trailers, actually. And I've, 7,000 people or 8,000 people would actually view the videos, and that produced sales. And that's been very useful for me. And every time people would suggest anything, I would try and run with it and develop it for myself. But it takes a lot of energy and a lot of work. So I've made it so that I write in the mornings and I do marketing at night. Uh-huh. I'm sitting with my husband. He's doing whatever he's doing, and I'm marketing my books.
Doing the whole Facebook game and sharing and all that kinds of good stuff.
I'm drawing people to my website and I'm talking to other authors and seeing what they're doing and trying to use their insights.
Well, who did you have this thing published with? Where did you go to get it published?
Just on KDP.
Okay.
Amazon KDP and Author Central on Amazon. Mm-hmm. And figured it out mostly by myself. And again, my good granddaughter, Soraya, helped me with, I'm fine with uploading everything, but she, stretching the creating the cover and then stretching it on there to meet the specifications was something that just overwhelmed me. So she just stepped in there and did all that for me.
Yeah. Well, and that is, I think, the key is you have to be a little bit tech savvy in order to get a properly formatted book. And that's where a lot of I'm seeing it on Facebook. A lot of people complain that, you know, they're not kicking my book out because I don't have the right cover on there, or I haven't done this, or I haven't done that. I've had my own problems with trying to format the thing. I had to get an Adobe Photoshop and pay for that. And it wasn't easy to come up with all the money to do with it. That's what I had to do to make this book work. But eventually, you know, we got there and we got the book published. You know, it helps to have a granddaughter that knows what she's doing, doesn't it?
Well, I see, the problem with it is that if you're concentrating on that stuff, then you're concentrating on that stuff. You're not being creative and writing. And I did find for a couple of months this year that I was so taken up with marketing the book and actually doing very well with it, that there was no creativity left for writing.
Yeah.
And so I had to push it all to one side so that I could concentrate on just writing, because my head was full of, if I do this and if I do that, I might it might produce more sales, et cetera, et cetera.
Well, and so I have the exact same problem, actually. I'm not selling my books at all right now. I have a book that I haven't even, it's all written. It's already voiced for audiobook, but I haven't managed to get it all formatted and finished editing and to publish it because I'm doing a podcast. And it's like,
I can't
just do the marketing.
Yes, And then I got together with a couple of, with a few other Irish writers, and we created a website called Lovers of Irish Culture. And it's grown very quickly, and we created it to showcase our work. But we also invite other writers, musicians, photographers, makers, etc., to showcase their stuff every Friday. We call it Feature Fridays. And that's the only day that I will use my at Irish author Carole Mondragon at the end of my posts. Otherwise, it's just Carole Mondragon, because I don't want to spam everybody. So we produced that that page, and it's been really useful. We've attracted so many people from all over the world, and we include mythology and folklore and other people's writings and history about Ireland. It's just been a wonderful experience. But again, it takes up a lot of time, and I've had to make sure that I pull back from that occasionally so that I can actually get some creative writing done myself.
Well, it makes perfect sense. And we have a time limit on this thing as well, unfortunately, so we're winding things down. But Carole, it has been an absolute pleasure having you today. And I hope everybody takes a look at the key to Clonacool. It is available on Amazon and anywhere you can find good books. And Carole, it has been a blast. But I hope you'll hang out with me for a couple more minutes, because what we're going to do, folks, right now is I'm going to end the episode. And for you folks that are in YouTube land and on the podcast, you are done for today. Thank you so much for joining us. It has been a pleasure to present the Authors Exchange, Carole Mondragon, The Key to Clonacool. And we're going to have to end the episode right now. So please join us each week at noon on Fridays for this episode. But for the rest of you, gonna wait to finish. Ready? It's done. Make sure you check out our Patreon page if you want to see this, because this is the end of the episode. That's it. You can't watch it anymore. Sorry. You have to go to the Patreon page if you want to see the rest of this. That's it. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.